Fighting for money is a story of exploitation. Wealthy brand owners and desperate outsiders who could do nothing but fight. It was an unregulated backwater, then incredibly niche, and then just another sport. Even if it did ultimately thrive off the intimate combat of two people.
It's morning again in America.
We Americans are slow to anger. We always seek peaceful avenues before resorting to the use of force.
A new world order. A world where the rule of law, not the law of the jungle, governs the conduct of nations.
This will be a long, ongoing struggle between freedom and fanaticism. We must be prepared to do all that we can for as long as we must.
Major financial institutions have teetered on the edge of collapse despite corrections in the marketplace and instances of abuse. Democratic capitalism is the best system ever devised.
No matter who you are or where you come from or what you look like or what religion you practice, you are equal in the eyes of God.
I don't know if sand can glow in the dark, but we're going to find out.
July 6, 2013, in Las Vegas, Nevada, Anderson Silva fell. By consensus, Silva is the greatest fighter on Earth. His body of work looked like that of a man who could read the thoughts of his opponents and unleash techniques that could only work in wire-fu cinema. It was easy to forget that, before that day, Silva was no stranger to defeat. Most notably, he'd suffered cartoonish submission losses to Japanese journeyman Ryo Chonin and Daisho Takase a decade prior. And though he came into his own and began to impose his Muay Thai heavy striking game with impunity on foes thereafter, he had a stretch of downright bland and confusing fights long after he'd captured the UFC title. UFC President Dana White even threatened to cut him if he continued to fight to the distance on the judges' scorecards rather than finish his opponents, as he had become wont to do. He ran into Chael Sonnen, a wrestler with an unimpressive-looking record and an aborted career in Republican politics. The question was whether Silva would snap Sonnen in two, as he used to, or fight like an asshole to make a fool of the big-talking Sonnen. It was neither, as it was Sonnen who made Silva look like every one of his 35 years. He whipped Silva's ass up and down the canvas before Sonnen dove into a combination triangle choke and armbar, the two techniques Sonnen was notorious for being caught in throughout his career. Suddenly, Silva was the hero. He went on to feed Vitor Belfort his foot and absorb all the fans in Brazil that the famous Belfort had, but Silva always wanted. He dismantled Sonnen's friend, Yushin Okami, in a horrifying display in Rio de Janeiro. He stepped in on late notice to face the inhumanly tough Stefan Bonner and became the first man to ever stop him on strikes. Silva clearly loved being the good guy. The Nike sponsorships and big deals were nice. But he clearly loved the fans in the US and Brazil exploding with joy whenever they saw him in a way they never had before. Even though Silva was in his late 30s, the fact that he was producing such highlights well into the twilight years of a fighter's lifespan seemed proof that he would never stop. Or at least he wouldn't for a while. Chris Weidman, on the other hand, came in with a shorter story. He had only 9 fights on his resume before challenging Silva for the belt. The vast majority of MMA fans figured that Weidman would punch air for a while and eventually get steamrolled like everyone else. Of course, those who trained with him said that his talent and aggression would carry him to victory against Silva, who had shown a vulnerability to similar balls-out wrestlers in the past. People could have seen the first round, where Weidman took Silva down and didn't let him up, but few saw him duffing out the champ in the next. It was an anticlimax. People thought Silva was clowning around and he'd take it more seriously in the rematch. When it came, Weidman beat the shit out of Silva even worse than he had the first time. Then he turned Silva's leg into jello when he blocked one of the Brazilian champion's ferocious leg kicks.
Oh my goodness! Oh my goodness! Oh my god!
Oh my goodness.
Anderson fractured his leg. You can see his leg hanging loose now. Wow! It snapped right in half.
Silva spent the next few years losing. Worse, he didn't lose like Anderson Silva. He didn't get blown up in the middle of some incredible technique. He didn't have unbelievable final matches with the next iteration of himself. He lost squeakers. He did once have a victory in the stretch, a drawn-out decision victory over a welterweight, Nick Diaz. It was overturned when the one-time protagonist of MMA pissed hot for performance-enhancing drugs. Using transitive properties that never worked in fight math, people decided that now Weidman was the best ever. After his decisive rematch of Silva, he dispatched 2 former champions, the aging Vitor Belfort, a one-time prodigy who found second life when he was allowed to shoot pure testosterone into his veins but was forced to stop when he ran into Weidman, and Lyoto Machida, the once light heavyweight king, going down 20 pounds to avenge his friend, Anderson Silva. Those 2 men were at one time considered unbeatable in their own rights. He was the next one that fans swore could never be stopped. Just like his forebears, he was shown to be human, dropping 3 fights in a row in violent circumstances. Neither of the men shown here are champions anymore. One of them will most likely never fight for the belt again. The other remains to be seen. But their first encounter is seared in the minds of even the most casual viewers. It's the touchstone of this modern era of fighting, where all things that used to make the sport unusual are mostly gone, and the impermanence and depersonalization that seems to pervade every facet of our lives has finally infected a sport once thought too weird and individualistic for that to ever happen. Mixed martial arts never changed our culture, as its detractors claimed it would. There was no epidemic of children killing each other with rear naked chokes. People still commit acts of violence against each other, but in the same ways and for the same reasons they always have. In retrospect, it's pretty fucking stupid. Why would a sport of consensual violence be so much worse for us in the developed world, where our governments bomb 7 countries before we even get out of bed in the morning? It will always be a bit of a fringe sport, but it's got the bland respectability of the capital side that the biggest promotional company always wanted. It somehow got to the point where it became so big and noticeable that it could be assimilated by the world around it. This story doesn't begin in sanitized Las Vegas, where the biggest promotion in the Ultimate Fighting Championship now resides, but continents away and hundreds of years before anyone could come up with a term like brand synergy. The true catalyst for MMA as a sport, business, and spectacle go back to Japan. While modern fighting attracts so many outsiders of society, its forebearer was the ultimate insider's art. Jiu-jitsu, a mixture of throws, strikes, joint locks, and chokes, was developed over hundreds of years by samurai. Originally purposed for these elite warriors to defeat armed opponents if they found themselves without any of their weaponry. In the rigid hierarchy of feudalism, the techniques of jiu-jitsu were kept from those who weren't samurai. But nothing can remain a secret forever. As Japan was open to the world, many of the feudal codes and customs that binded so many spaces in society started to wither. By the 19th century, jiu-jitsu had proliferated to the point where one didn't have to be a samurai to learn it. But it still wasn't accessible to very many. One had to have a certain degree of size and athleticism to bring the techniques from practice to execution. That was until someone wanted something that we now take for a given in the sport. To use martial arts as a fulcrum against those parts of oneself that make them feel as though they did not belong. In the New Japan, a man named Kanojigaro had a problem. He wanted to be the best jiu-jitsu competitor that he could possibly be, but he was just too small. Kano was the type of outsider now typical to the modern sport of fighting. He knew every mitigating factor of his identity so well that it informed his most pivotal desires and decisions. Though he attended high-end private schools and received tutoring, he was still prisoner to a 5'2", 90-pound frame. Kano found a dojo and an instructor. He tried his best. He practiced his forms, he sparred, and did everything that he could, but he was just too small and too green to beat his more experienced betters. Kano never stopped believing he had a path to victory and mastery, though. The same straying road that led such a small kid to jiu-jitsu in the first place brought him to Western wrestling, sumo, and any other grappling art he could study in order to surprise his larger training partners. It didn't matter then, in a Japan that had reformed away its elite warrior nobility. It doesn't matter now, in any first world nation, in any rich family, in a blue-collar family, in an impoverished landlocked country, or if you grew up in a scientific colony in Antarctica. As long as there are people, they'll at some point want the ability to keep someone from kicking their ass. No matter how unlikely it is that they'll ever actually get into a fight. Jigaro Kano probably would have never gotten into a fight if he had never taken this path. But he had. Through the next few years, Kano started achieving some proficiency, even demonstrating the art to then-President Ulysses S. Grant during a state visit. But it wasn't until he came under the instruction of a master named Ikubo Tsunetoshi that he truly found his niche. Tsunetoshi was more into throwing techniques than any other instructor Kano had studied under, and for someone who was obsessed with getting around his size and strength differentials, throws were perfect. Since they centered around using an opponent's weight and leverage to impose one's will, they could theoretically be employed by a smaller man to dominate larger foes. It wasn't long until Kano embarked on his own. Originally, he was just another jiu-jitsu teacher. He hadn't quite realized that he'd built something quite different until he began beating Tsunetoshi in randori, or sparring. What Kano had figured out was that instead of just muscling into a throw, he could apply a series of pulls, pushes, arm drags, and dozens of other techniques from other grappling arts to manipulate his opponent's frame so they'd be in an optimal position to be tossed. Once they were on the ground, Kano could then apply choking techniques that he'd learned from different schools of jiu-jitsu. While it seems like a no-shit revelation now, it was revolutionary at a time when martial arts were very rarely blended in a way that's commonplace today. Kano named his new system Judo. Judo is now an Olympic sport, and thousands of masters, athletes, and enthusiasts trace their instructor lineage directly back to Kano himself. Kano changed martial arts forever. His students made up some of the most notable names in fighting for years to come. But for our purposes, he had a singularly important pupil. Mitsuya Maeda became a judo champion and traveled the world giving exhibitions of the novel art. After hundreds of years, martial arts had finally broken containment. It was first jealously guarded by the elite, then accessible only to those with certain physical abilities, then opened up by Kano to virtually every type of person, no matter how small. Now, in the first great era of globalization, martial arts were ripe to be altered and adapted. The entire sport of mixed martial arts owes its existence to Mitsuya Maeda and the winding transcontinental path that brought him to Brazil. Gastão Gracie was a member of an elite family. His ancestors emigrated from Scotland to Brazil a few generations back and married into one of the nation's richest families. Gastão was a businessman, diplomat, and as is so common in families with too much money, father to a troublemaker son. Gastão had helped Maeda set up a settlement for Japanese emigres in the state of Pará. In return, he asked Maeda to teach his rowdy son Carlos the way of judo. Up until that point, Carlos had satisfied his adolescent aggression by brawling in the streets. Despite, or maybe in spite of, his wealthy background, he was notorious for taking on any comer he could find, Maeda turned him into a martial artist, and even the master of his own school. But that desire to take on all comers never went away. And when synthesized with the Gracie family's marketing acumen, it came in handy. In order to promote their system, the Gracies took out ads in newspapers, calling for challengers to test their mettle against the family's judo. Gostow was once a partner in a circus enterprise, and it reflected in his progeny. It resulted in a new enterprise called Vale Chudo, Portuguese for anything goes. These fights were spectacles, and they had no real rules outside of prohibiting biting or eye gouging, and that wasn't even really uniform. Their promotional dominance did not mean that they weren't really bleeding in there. Few in the history of Vale Chudo, in fact, bled like Elio Gracie did. Elio was another one of Gastão's sons, but he was said to have been very sick with an unspecified illness when he was younger. As such, he turned out smaller than his brothers, who were already slight of frame. Though judo was ideally supposed to work for any body, some techniques did require a bit more body and a bit more power than Elio could offer. Like Kano generations before him, Elio refined the art even more, making it more efficient, more simple, and more effective against the right opponents. Instead of emphasizing the high-velocity takedowns of judo, Elio relied on simple trip takedowns and body locks that often looked ugly but got the job done. The truth was, it actually didn't matter if Elio could land an unambiguous wrestling maneuver that put his opponent's ass flat on the floor. All he had to do was create a scramble, and that's when his superior training in floor sparring would allow him to get top position and eventually submit that other judoka and wrestler without all that extra effort. Several Gracie men and their students excelled in Vale Chudo through sheer excellence, promotional ratfucking, or a combination of both, but none of them put in the kind of hours that Elio did. He quite often won, but usually after putting in a superhuman effort, and almost always after getting maimed pretty badly. It was a regular occurrence for his fights to last hours, as his losing effort against former student Valdemir Santana did. In his most famous match, Elio took on Matsuhiko Kimura, a judo wonderkind who outweighed him by about 45 pounds. While it was billed as a super fight, it didn't last quite as long as Elio's other matches. Kimura had been told by the Japanese embassy that he wouldn't be allowed back in the country if he lost, and he fought as such. He ragdolled Elio with numerous throws and tried to end the night in a variety of holds. Finally, at the 13-minute mark, he got Elio in a Gayuka Ude Garame, or double wrist lock, which twists an opponent's arm behind their back in such a way that it isolates their shoulder and elbow joints and puts tremendous pressure on them. It was a deep hold, but Elio, of course, refused to give up. Kimura obliged the Brazilian, and he broke his arm. Elio still didn't give up, and he would probably still be there trying to attain some type of moral victory if his corner hadn't thrown in the towel. Other Gracies who took part in Vale Chudo did not endure such insane tests of will, but Elio seemed to fight for the honor of Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. It's a pretty common thing for rich Westerners to fetishize Japanese culture, and the Gracies were no different. It was just that Elio was one of the few weeaboos who'd have died to prove he was just like a samurai if they had let him. Elio is credited as one of the inventors of Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. While most of these fights were grappler versus striker matchups, personal drama of students fighting their former masters, or general exhibitions meant to demonstrate the superiority of the Gracie family, something unexpected happened. Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu had blown up, but in many ways, the Gracies had become just like the samurai who used to keep their Jiu-Jitsu from everyone else. For one, they restricted their most advanced techniques to their own family, lest anyone break their monopoly. Then, there was also the matter of the gi. Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu was for people who could afford the gi, the uniform needed to train. There were millions of people that couldn't spare a few reals to buy these heavy cotton pajamas, but they wanted to train and fight as anyone else would. If you think Brazil has absurd wealth inequality now, you should have seen it in the middle of the 20th century. Lucha Livre came from the lower classes of Brazil. They couldn't afford the enormous gymnasiums the jiu-jitsu schools would often occupy, and would sometimes train in the street or alleyways. Lucha Livre was a hard-nosed sport, and its adherents were usually people who had been exploited their entire lives. Jiu-jitsu was for the rich kids. Lucha Livre was for the 99%. The Gracie clan derided a lot of their techniques. Foot and leg locks that the Lucha Livre practitioners used were referred to as suburban. It means a different, more classist thing over there, and barbaric. In the 1980s, this rivalry dominated Vale Chudo after the 1982 Naja Academy gym invasion. Charles Gracie had a fistfight over a woman with Muay Thai boxer Mario Duma, and when his brother Halls Gracie found out, he rounded up his students. We'll probably never know for sure exactly how that day ended, whether Gracie beat Duma in a fair fight, or instigated an all-out brawl between the two academies. What is known is that Halls and company marched all the way through the streets of Rio de Janeiro to Naja Academy, where Duma was training to settle the score. There were several fight cards built around the Lucha Livre BJJ rivalry thereafter, but the hatred wasn't confined. It often spilled out of the rings and gyms and onto the streets. There were countless brawls between groups representing the two arts, as more than martial arts proficiency lay on the line. It wasn't just black and white class resentment either, though. Some craved upward mobility so bad that they would work long hours and skip meals just to be able to afford jiu-jitsu training, hoping to achieve not just money in the Vale Chudo ring, but the middle-class cachet that jiu-jitsu offered. To fight members of their own class wasn't just about defending the name of jiu-jitsu, though. It was about clawing their way upwards in a stratified Brazilian society. Some in the Gracie clan focused intensely on hard-nosed Lucha Livre athletes. Carlson Gracie developed a different style of jiu-jitsu than his forebears, an extremely aggressive and physical style that married the sheer physicality of Lucha Livre with the gentle art of Gracie jiu-jitsu. The more moneyed wing of this large clan had designs past this proto-MMA, however. Though they enjoyed brisk business through their schools, Vale Chudo cards, and videotape series well into the 20th century, the wealthy descendants of a former circus promoter had determined the next logical step: pay-per-view. ...1976 saw two abortive attempts at the future. The first was Ronald Reagan's strong but ultimately unsuccessful primary attempt on then-President Gerald Ford. Reagan surged from Ford's right flank, attacking the amiable establishment choice for losing Vietnam and kowtowing to collectivist forces everywhere else in the world, especially at home. The two fought tooth and nail, but Reagan faltered down the stretch. Ford ended up retaining his title of the Republican Party's nomination en route to a loss to Jimmy Carter. Around the same time in the same year, boxing legend Muhammad Ali took on Japanese pro wrestling icon Antonio Inoki. You couldn't call it a fight, so we'll say it was a contest. How it came to be, no one can quite agree on. Inoki spent most of the 15-round competition in the butt scoot position, and Ali threw six punches, so it's understandable that no one wants to claim the rule set that allowed this. Inoki versus Ali ended in a draw, and was largely unentertaining. And Ronald Reagan was a joke outside of hardcore conservative Republican primary voters. World War the elderly actor was a threat on the national stage, and proto-MMA existed outside of gymnasiums in Brazil. Both seemed pretty unlikely in 1976.
I must tell those who fail to report for duty this morning, they are in violation of the law, and if they do not report for work within 48 hours, they have forfeited their jobs and will be terminated. End of statement.
The 1980s were spent destroying the breakwaters that the West once felt protected its people from the worst excesses of their own systems. Margaret Thatcher and Ronald Reagan broke the backs of unions, ripped the spines out of their prospective nations' welfare states, and used a series of banana republics as punching bags in their succession of small wars meant to heal the wounded pride caused by Vietnam and the tumultuous 1970s. Social safety nets, higher wages, and other cushions the West was obliged to have in order to draw its working classes away from communism were ripped away. We were naked to the winds of an uncertain world. Ollie and Inoki were a bit too early and a bit too weird, but it was now a great time to destroy our cultural ideal of martial arts. There were many champions in the Gracie family. Hickson excelled at Valley Judo. Boiler dominated in pure jiu-jitsu tournaments. But lawyer and businessman Horion was the best at marketing, which was the language of the new world that the Gracies found themselves in. After spending the tail end of the 80s getting the Gracie name out through Playboy, Street Fight videos, and everything else he could think of, Horion finally linked up with marketing director Art Davey. Seeking to monetize the mythical family from Brazil who said they could kick the shit out of anyone, the two settled on pay-per-view. It almost ended in Gracie Civil War. One faction wanted the telegenic and athletic Hickson to compete, but Hickson and Horion were both too large in personality to come to any agreement. After near inner office fights, the slighter in frame Hoist Gracie was selected. In 1993, no one knew anything, and most people still thought that if you did karate the right way, you could blow up somebody's heart. The call was, we're looking for people to fight in a tournament where the only real rules are you can't bite someone or gouge their eyes out. We want to figure out what's the best kind of fighting. Winner gets $50,000. Who would answer a call like that? The eight constituting the tournament included an insanely dirty kickboxer, a massive sumo wrestler, a respected but bewildered boxer who ended up wearing one glove to the octagon, and two guys who stood above the rest. We already know Hoist, the diminutive scion of grappling royalty, but his eventual counterpart and partner in fate was Ken Shamrock. Shamrock was a street tough, taken in by an adoptive father, whose last name he ended up taking. A standout athlete who ended up in pro wrestling in Japan. There, he materialized in Pancrazy, a weird pro wrestling slash real fighting hybrid where fighters had to wear thigh-high boots and could only strike with open palms. Shamrock looked like he was chiseled out of rock using the sharpest needles filled with the finest anavar and seemed intense and cool in a now embarrassing 1990s way. Shamrock and Gracie tore through their first opponents before meeting in the semifinals. When they met, Shamrock and his bowling ball deltoids outweighed Gracie by 40 pounds of pure muscle. Though Shamrock was just an inch taller than his opponent, the musculature difference was the kind you see in political cartoons making a point about an underdog. He and Shamrock entangled on the floor, where Gracie used his gi to his advantage, cutting off Shamrock's windpipe and carotid arteries. Shamrock protested, but then admitted that he tapped. Gracie went on to fight notoriously dirty Dutch fighter Gerard Gordeau. Gordeau bit Gracie's ear. To pay him back, Gracie held on to his rear naked choke just a little longer than he needed to. T To the tens of thousands who had watched it, the cultural image of martial arts was altered forever. The men with coolly named East Asian techniques, the yoked pro wrestler, the boxer, they all fell to a man who dragged them to the floor and turned their lights off by touching their necks. Fighting was evolving at previously unseen rates. Ultimate fighters, who were thought to have solved the puzzle of martial arts, fell again and again, downed by new champions. These were men like former elite college wrestler Dan Severn, Russian standout Oleg Taktarov, and one of the first fully versatile fighters in Marco Huas. Huas, a lucha libre fighter, won the UFC 7 tournament, chopping down Paul Varlins with a ruthless series of leg kicks so thunderous that they eventually sent the 300-pounder to the mat. No matter who would walk away with the prize, the sport resonated with outsiders in a world now filled to the brim with them. Why then? Why did all these unwashed masses now clamor for these weird men brutalizing each other? To paraphrase Inspector Javert to Jean Valjean, I'd only known a straight line before I'd met you. Let's look at the culture at the time. As America had just begun to survey the rapid destruction of the 1980s, the new professional culture of the 1990s had arrived. It offered yoga and smoothies, but retained the same bloodlessness. NAFTA made goods cheaper for some, the Clinton crime bill took all those nasty super predators off the street. There was a new set of platitudes about tolerance that everyone could feel good about, as the lines between their professional and personal lives blurred. Or they were just totally dislocated in this new world they were told they'd love. The term politically correct, and then the backlash against it, started taking hold at this time. We usually hear complaints about PC when someone is told they can't shout racial slurs at a Little League game, but it betrays something to think about. This all started becoming a thing when our corporations began coalescing into state-like entities that could fill all our needs. Their human resources departments, afraid of backlash, instituted standards that often protected vulnerable employees, but at other times enforced standards and beliefs, outside activities, and anything that would make one too different for the workplace through fear of being fired. Since we have such little recourse against our employers, it was a culturally significant tool. There were obviously good outcomes. It's good to take people's feelings into consideration. But it was never PC culture. It was HR culture. The main point is not to protect the individual now, but the company. We never really stopped doing things because we cared about the feelings of others. We did them because we'd be shoved out of a window with no net to catch us. Seeing a bunch of insane men with dumb tattoos cover one another in blood was a release from the bloodless brutality of life. As everyone in power swept up the macho posturing violence of the Reagan years with the reserve sanitized new violence, it was stark to see men who said, "We're fucked up, we don't fit in anywhere, and we will beat each other to death if it means we can survive." Of course, MMA had a very undiverse audience at this time. While as a spectacle, it was noticed by many different types of people, its core fan base was overwhelmingly white and male. There were a great deal of suburban petite bourgeois who could afford to buy those pay-per-views consistently. Then there were a lot of guys who were lower on the totem pole. Among the latter, there are those who felt their prestige in society had taken a hit and blamed that on whatever group they already hated the most. And then the others who were just checked out. Regardless who their bitterness was directed at, the unambiguous nature of the combat portrayed was a cultural reprieve from an increasingly confusing world. The 1-2 path of a punch to a guy snoring on the ground was still the same. Unfortunately for the sport, the wrong people also took notice. Senator John McCain, who spent his early adulthood dropping explosives in napalm on a tiny agrarian nation until he was shot down, famously likened it to human cockfighting. Of course, McCain was also a huge boxing fan, a sport that offers a similar degree of brain damage in addition to being a market competitor for the then-nascent UFC. And his wife, Cindy McCain, inherited a large distributor for Anheuser-Busch, a beer company that spent untold millions on boxing sponsorships. But it's not like John McCain had some documented history of using his pull for personal ends.
Anyway, McCain was so shocked and appalled by the trashy violence of the cage that he could probably barely watch B-roll of huts bursting into flames in Hanoi that night. So he initiated a campaign to effectively ban mixed martial arts.
UFC 9 was right after McCain's assault on the freedom to consensual violence. The main event saw a superfight between former tournament champions Dan Severn and Ken Shamrock. With new rules in place, the two men could not strike each other with closed fists, lest they be arrested. What happened next was an interminable affair.
Shamrock immediately moved to the UFC logo in the center of the ring. He didn't leave that spot for 10 minutes and did nothing but pivot towards Severn and stare. Severn, for his part, circled around Shamrock and stared back at him.
And neither one willing to take a shot.
He circled him again and again and again.
Still nothing happening.
Neither fighter even attempted a strike, save for a single half-hearted jab every minute or two.
And you gotta keep your strategies, maintain your poise.
This went on for 10 full minutes until referee John McCarthy temporarily stopped the fight. By that time, Severn had made 35 complete orbits around Shamrock. By a rough estimate, Severn had danced about 2,900 feet, a little more than half a mile.
Can't just stare at each other.
The half-hour fight ended in a split decision, although it's hard to imagine anyone who paid $19.95 for the pay-per-view sticking around until the end.
These are two of the greatest fighters in the world, but they're not fighting.
The damage was done.
SEG, the UFC's parent company, suddenly had trouble finding places to fight. Within a matter of months, revenue had sharply declined. Despite their best efforts to work with athletic commissions, it was taking its toll on the promotion.
Until an angel came in and saved the sport. A seedy, depraved angel. Let's dig up its bones.
It's the 1950s in Galveston, Texas, a hotbed of organized crime. The Maceo family operates a racket that rakes in millions through gambling, prostitution, and the oil business. Joseph Francis Fertitta marries into the family, and soon, the Fertittas and Maceos find themselves in the paper together. In 1960, the law finally comes down in Galveston, and the Fertittas scatter.
Some resurface in the desert, including Francis Fertitta's son, Frank Jr. Frank spends 15 years working in Las Vegas casinos before founding one of his own with a business partner, Carl Thomas. It's called Bingo Palace, and in a few short years, it becomes the sole property of Fertitta when Thomas is convicted by the feds for illegal skimming practices. Fertitta changes the name and launches the Station Casinos empire, and it makes the family very, very rich. So rich that in 2001, Frank's sons Lorenzo and Frank III, also known as Frankie Three Sticks, not making that up, team up with their childhood friend Dana White to buy the UFC. Dana was a boxercise instructor who had to evacuate Boston because, according to him, feared New England mobster Whitey Bulger tried to extort him. It's a very normal company. Previously, the UFC had cleaned up its rules and tried everything it could to lobby state governments to sanction their fights. But none of those politicians seemed to listen.
But in the year 2000, the New Jersey State Athletic Commission established some common sense rules. This set of prohibitions and standards was known as the Unified Rules of Mixed Martial Arts. It established mixed martial arts as legitimate.
How did Dana White and the Fertittas push this through so quickly after years of futility on SEG's part? Well, the Fertittas were very well connected in Republican politics, and as for Dana White, well...
Good evening, everyone! My name is Dana White. I am the president of the Ultimate Fighting Championship. Thank you. I'm sure most of you are wondering, what are you doing here? In 2001, my partners and I bought the UFC, and it was basically considered a blood sport. State Athletic Commission didn't support us. Arenas around the world refused to host our events. Nobody took us seriously. Nobody. Except Donald Trump. Donald was the first guy that recognized the potential that we saw in the UFC and encouraged us to build our business. He hosted our first two events at his venue. He dealt with us personally. He got in the trenches with us, and he made a deal that worked for everyone. On top of that, he showed up for the fight on Saturday night and sat in the front row. Yeah, he's that guy. He shows up. Donald championed the UFC before it was popular, before it grew into a successful business, and I will always be grateful, so grateful to him for standing with those with us in those early days. So tonight, I stand with Donald Trump. And let's be honest, folks, we need somebody who believes in this country, we need somebody who's proud of this country, and who will fight for this country.
The dark age of the UFC was over. Those forgotten years, though, saw some new stars. Guys like Bas Rutten, Tudor Ortiz, Chuck Liddell, these were people who specialized in styles like their predecessors, but were well-rounded enough that they could implement their malice far more artfully. Still, if a juice to the gills man takes you down and smashes your head in, but you're banned in a bunch of places and can't get on the air, did it really happen? Japan. Our former foe in the Pacific had experienced what economists call a post-war miracle, as their economy reached unforeseen growth for decades, to the point that they had the world's second highest gross domestic product and a per capita income as high or higher than any of its Western counterparts from the 70s to the 80s. By the early 80s, Japan surpassed the US in production of cars and electronics, and its richest institutions were eyeing up prized American real estate. The trade deficit between the two states ballooned. That booming Japanese economy? It turns out for that last decade, it was due to our old friends, cheap credit and overspeculation. Real estate stocks and every other kind of instrument was so overpriced after the 1980s that the Bank of Japan tried to halt the resulting inflation by massively increasing their interest rates that banks could lend each other money with. This caused prices of those overvalued equities to crater, and since every major institution was loaded with debt from trying to buy more assets, they were now totally underwater and unable to meet their basic payments. The government swooped in to rescue firms that were too big to fail, guaranteeing their debt and injecting them with more capital. These were called zombie firms, lurching shells of their former over-borrowing selves who were worth less than their combined assets as they shuffled around aimlessly in post-bubble Japan. Lenders who once cut a check to anyone with a pulse now barely opened their books at all. Youth unemployment surged, wages fell, Japan's economy lost a fifth of its value. But someone had money, and a lot of it. People didn't stop needing money just because the banks told them no. They turned to loan sharks, and in Japan, loan sharks often belong to the preeminent organized crime groups, Yakuza. Yakuza, like anyone else, have to park their money somewhere. The openly trashy UFC was America's answer to the pain of dislocation and a changing antiseptic world. The grand Baroque display of Pride Fighting Championship was an oasis for a beleaguered, staggering Japan. In 1997, the UFC was toiling in the dark ages. They could fill smaller venues, but guys were mostly giving and receiving brain damage for archival footage that would be seen by most decades after the fact. At the same time in Japan, Pride's first event, a match between the legendary Hickson Gracie and Nobuhiko Takada, drew 47,000 fans at the Tokyo Dome.
While the UFC was still working out the kinks of its supposedly safer rule set, Pride fighters were permitted to soccer kick an opponent's head. It's exactly what it sounds like, as Mirko Krokop demonstrates here against the unfortunate Ron Waterman.
Their opening rounds went a grueling 10 minutes. Instead of matching up a ladder, they did one-night tournaments as the UFC once did. Only the loose medical oversight and the promotion's pro-steroid policy allowed Pride's champions to so consistently break laws of God and man. It also didn't hurt that this was the start of the second era of MMA. The first one, the one of the early UFC, was characterized by fighters only excelling at one set of skills. It was striker versus grappler, wrestler versus judo player, etc. By the time that Pride rolled around, MMA athletes began developing secondary skill sets that would allow them to oppose their primary ones.
Ukrainian Igor Vovchanchin, originally just a kickboxer, developed a command of advanced punching techniques in addition to becoming more formidable while grappling on the ground. It was tough for a relatively single-faceted jiu-jitsu player like Francisco Bueno to know how to attack him. So Bueno didn't. A minute in, he got danced into a corner and suffered one of the most brutal knockouts in the history of the sport. Wrestlers like Rampage Jackson developed rudimentary boxing that enabled them to set up their takedowns, or, as we see here, use the threat of his takedown to surprise Kevin Randleman with a barrage of strikes.
Unsurprisingly, what started out big only got bigger. Because of the influence of both pro wrestling and involvement with organized crime, there was a lot of silly bullshit. Your typical Pride card may have been headlined by, say, Russian hard-ass Fedor Emelianenko versus Croatian Special Forces Officer Mirko Krokop, a match steeped in nationalism, history, and feverish anticipation of seeing a guy who could seemingly walk through anything to win against a man with a ballistic missile for a left high kick to determine who was truly the scariest Eastern European stoic. You would get some other legit fights, legends like Takanori Gomi, Hayato Sakurai, and Shogun Hua, but they would be sandwiched in between matches that were kind of like fat guy versus whoever.
Consider Bob Sapp, who was enormous, artless, and beloved by everyone. Once an offensive lineman for the Minnesota Vikings, all 350 pounds of him were suspended by the NFL for alleged steroid use. A few years later, he showed up in the Pride ring with nothing but football and pro wrestling on his resume and zero actual martial arts ability. In his second fight, he met Kiyoshi Tamura, a disciplined veteran who had notched wins over several notable fighters, including Henzo Gracie. Sapp, who outweighed Tamura by 150 pounds, appeared to have absolutely no plan of attack beyond bull rushing him and throwing a haymaker. That plan, plus 11 seconds, was all he needed. This was not the early UFC. It was not an ostensibly noble quest to determine the superior fighting style. It was a promotion rife with freak shows that showed enormous crowds what it looked like when a normal-looking guy got hit by an enormous strong guy. Management often fucked with fighters, switching their opponents at the last minute to psych them out and giving them only a week or two to prepare. Multiple fighters alleged some matches were fixed outright.
The one fight more or less confirmed by a participant to be rigged was former UFC champion Mark Coleman diving into a heel hook from Nobuhiko Takada, who, by all rights, should have been plastered all over the mat by Coleman. Said Coleman years later, "I needed to support my family. They guaranteed me another fight after that, and I needed that security. It was what it was. I'm going to leave it at that." Pride was often not even close to a legitimate sporting event. But for all the freak shows, rigged fights, and weird bullshit, it could feel bigger than a sport, too. Take Mauricio Shogun Hua and his otherworldly 2005 tournament run. At a time where most fighters could juice to their heart's content, Shogun didn't look like the Olympia competitor his opponents and his shoot box stablemates resembled. The guys who dominated the tables in Pride had looks, howling rage, terrifying iciness, or smart-ass attitudes that endeared the marketing side as well as the matchmakers.
Some quiet 23-year-old who smiled bashfully when interviewed was not the type.
He had the body of a podcaster who hits the gym a few times a week, but also the youthful good looks and friendly affect of a podcaster. He was just an unlikely tournament hero. Most thought he would fare fine in the 2005 middleweight Grand Prix, but would ultimately wash out. He was dealt American wrestle boxer Quinton Rampage Jackson on his first go. In under 5 minutes, he rocked Jackson, pulverized his body, and bullied him into a corner where he stomped him out like he was an NFL t-shirt someone burned in a protest gone awry. He drew rival camp Brazilian top teams Antonio Rogério Nogueira in its next go. Nogueira was the twin brother of former Pride heavyweight champion Antonio Rodrigo Nogueira, a famously tough fighter who survived being run over by a fruit truck as a child, temporary paralysis, and its resulting physical limitations to become an impossible-to-finish grappling phenom. His brother wasn't as good a grappler, but being that he avoided the fruit truck, Rogério was a little lighter, a little faster, and a far better boxer. This is when Shogun's luck was supposed to run out, but there was no luck at play. The younger fighter pushed Rogério to the limit. Both men dropped each other, but Shogun got the edge through takedowns and aggression. These fights were weeks apart. However, Shogun had a double date later in the month to determine the tournament's final conclusion. First, Alistair Overeem, a physical specimen who suffered from front-runner syndrome and trainers who made such an unusually big man cut to 205 pounds and nearly die every time. Still, Alistair had dangerous power and a guillotine choke from hell. But Shogun had already savaged one superstar and triumphed over another. He stopped the Dutchman at 6 minutes and 42 seconds in the first round.
Stop it! Shogun continues!
This was where things were supposed to get truly difficult. Ricardo Arona was the asshole of Brazilian MMA. A chiseled specimen next to Shogun's normie gym guy, Arona was a rich kid Lothario who never saw a way to fight dirty that he didn't like. He did everything he could to be an absolute prick in his matches. He stuck his thumbs in Kazushi Sakuraba's wounds to keep them open during their fight. A year later, he would go on to force a tap out from Alistair Overeem, then deliver an absolutely filthy late hit. Instead of stopping fights with his unequaled technique, Arona would just lay on people, suffocating their movement and waiting until the final bell rang. He did this to Wanderlei Silva in the previous round. So Shogun, the one from Shootbox with worse takedown defense and more youthful imprudence, was fucked, right? Shogun started out the fight with a flying tornado kick and was immediately taken down. This is where it's supposed to end, with the young upstart making a quick mistake and being sentenced to several minutes of prone sweating. But if it wasn't apparent by now, Shogun was special. Shogun's hips immediately opened up, and instead of desperately hanging on in hopes of keeping Arona from a better position, he snatched an incredibly rare omoplata submission, where one does a near full circle from their backs while catching the person on top's arm in their hips so as to pop out their shoulder joint. The omoplata wasn't about to be finished, but Shogun had no intention of stopping the fight that way. Instead, he used his newly gained top position to escape the ground, went for a stomp on Arona's smug face, missed, then beat his fucking brains in, becoming the unlikely Grand Prix champion only 2 minutes and 34 seconds into round one. In retrospect, it made a ton of sense. Shogun was the first really excellent athlete of the two-dimensional era, and was an absolute offensive powerhouse in his two main arsenals, Muay Thai on the feet and utter brutality on the ground. But everything is always inevitable after it happens. While it's unfolding, you still get to suspend your disbelief and watch the narrative that binds all great fights. Shogun's run was everything people loved about Pride. It was an insane spectacle that, despite itself, told stories through its fights that transcended what was a very niche sport on the other side of the ocean. Let's check in on that other side of that ocean while we're here. Remember the first big push for MMA in the United States, when culture was getting cleaned up and the economy was getting more degrading for more people? It was just as quickly thrown into the Dark Ages, while Japan and Limbo played out its wildest fantasies with the same sport. But when it came back into our cultural imagination, we were more ready for it this time. America in 2005 was drunk off cheap credit and revenge manifested as endless warfare. And while we used our imperial might to impart our superior way of life on hapless nations, we let a major American city drown amidst billions allocated to the nebulous concept of homeland security. It was a good time for a select group, those who could benefit from quick credit, short-term investments, or prosthetic sales for American troops. But in our unconscious minds, we saw our WASP secret society president pretend to be a simple cowboy while he spewed megachurch bullshit about how God was his close personal friend. Our culture had an insatiable need for violence, but Iraq was now just too real, with Americans dying in scores in asymmetrical warfare. We loved the concept of revenge, but couldn't deal with the cost of how it was dealt to the unsuspecting weddings, schools, and hospitals on the other side of the world. But there was some very real, very consensual violence that did not cause body bags filled with Americans or the humiliation of an empire that could be found in mixed martial arts. The unambiguity of fighting didn't hurt either. When we called a bunch of Ivy League dickheads profiting off of people's shitty credit ownership society and mass murder nation building, it was nice to see two guys fucking demolish each other without someone telling you it was competitive self-learning or whatever beforehand. Your home belongs to the bank, your gas tank is lining the pockets of those who had more to do with 9/11 than the country your brother just died fighting in, and you're told the economy is in high gear even though your paycheck is buying less and less. But what you just saw in the cage was unambiguous. One person hit another and the other fell. Nothing about it lied to you. In other words, the earnest UFC was actually seeing the benefits of a nation that needed something as tangible as tribal tattoos and knockouts.
First, they had some unusually successful pay-per-views thanks to the stoic Chuck Liddell, the wizened Randy Couture, and the muddle-mouthed trash talk of Tito Ortiz.
While they were losing so much money the Fertittas considered selling the company, they went all in on reality TV and it paid off big. The Ultimate Fighter placed 16 fighters in a gaudy Vegas McMansion as they fought through a tournament to decide the Ultimate Fighter himself. Its first season finally showed regular American cable-watching families the world of MMA. The stars of Tough One were all the types of bizarre human beings you find in the sport, from the irony-poisoned but tougher-than-dog-shit Forrest Griffin to the inconceivably prickish Josh Koscheck. Audiences were dispelled of the notion of fighters as Terminators who lived, breathed, and slept harming other human beings. Instead of T-1000, we saw John Connor. A bunch of fucked-up outcasts who could be funny, vulnerable, cruel, petty, and compassionate in the ways that people who never really gelled anywhere in society could.
The show exposed casual viewers to the sometimes bleak realities of fighting for a living. In the third episode, light heavyweight Bobby Southworth found himself with only 24 hours to make weight for his fight against Ludon Sincaid. Within those 24 hours, he had to somehow cut approximately 20 pounds. An impossible task for the uninitiated, but a common practice in the world of fighting. His teammate, Josh Koscheck, and his coach, Chuck Liddell, shut him inside a sauna for one-hour intervals, behind a door with a sign on it that recommended no more than 20 minutes. Southworth, wearing a sweatsuit on top of a plastic suit, pedaled a stationary bike in the 210-degree heat. For a while, anyway. He eventually lied down, and was so weakened by the end of the hour that he had to butt-scoot his way out of a room hot enough to slow-cook a brisket. 2 hours before the weigh-in, Southworth still had 3 pounds left to lose, so it was back to the sauna for him. By this point, his kidneys were aching, and he had to be dragged back in. When it was all over, Southworth had just barely made weight. He would eventually knock out his opponent in the second round. But to the average cable viewer, the superhuman feat of strength was the one they had already seen.
A reality TV producer with all the Adderall and non-union contracts in the world couldn't have planned the finale, though. With the show itself being a tournament structure, the finale featured the top two fighters in both of the season's weight classes vie for a vaunted six-figure UFC contract.
The UFC, being very much who they are, split the contract across 3 years and wouldn't pay out the maximum amount unless the fighter went undefeated. So it wasn't a guaranteed annual contract, but they sure fought like it was.
3.3 million people watched Stephen Bonner fight Forrest Griffin in the finale. It was beyond the wildest expectations of Dana White, Lorenzo, and Frank Fertitta. UFC 52, where Tough One coaches Chuck Liddell and Randy Couture squared off in a rematch of a pre-reality TV fight that Liddell dropped, did 300,000 buys. That was double the previous record, and it was the new normal. The modern UFC was built on the blood and scar tissue shed on the mat that night. Pride, then the top promotion in the world, had some real competition. A victor would be declared, but not before America finally crashed from its upper high, and the rest of the world had to go through the same withdrawals as us.
The promotion that once nearly vanished from the face of the earth now had aims of taking it over. Dana was beginning to set goals once thought impossible for the sport. Years later, in 2013, the UFC's Twitter account tweeted out a photo that they soon deleted for reasons unclear. This photo showed Dana and the Fertittas standing below three words in big, bold letters that suddenly seemed a lot less crazy than they would have back when they were holding fights in a Mississippi casino. During the 1990s, MMA was nearly legislated out of existence in America. A decade later, the sport was fighting for its life in Japan. Shuken Gendai, a weekly news magazine, claimed that Pride FC had connections to Yakuza, in one issue, going so far as to illustrate a shadowy figure hovering over a Pride ring. Among their charges were that Pride founder Nobuyuki Sekigahara had connections with alleged organized crime figure Mr. Ishizaka, also known as Mr. I and Kim Duk-soo. In addition to Sekigahara, Mr. I resided in the same building as Pride head producer Kunio Kiyohara. The magazine said that Mr. I resided on the 31st floor, and Pride stars like judo Olympian Hidehiko Yoshida were seen attending soirees at the alleged criminal's home. Sekigahara categorically denied Shuken Gendai's accusations, and Kiyohara brushed them off when confronted. But it didn't help his case that Yakuza were so frequently in the front rows of Pride events, and that rumors swirled of the bosses hanging out backstage with fighters and even having all-out brawls against the backdrop of the sporting violence Pride offered out front. In May of 2006, Shuken Gendai called on Fuji TV, the network that brought Pride into the homes of millions, to save their souls by not renewing their deal with the company that coming September. In June, Fuji and Pride cut ties. The ambitious promotion tried to proceed like nothing was wrong. They still went forward with their first show in the United States, with Pride 32 in Las Vegas. It only sold a paltry 40,000 pay-per-view buys. Later, they tried to outdo their most bombastic New Year's Eve shows by contracting Mike Tyson for their card that year. But criminal charges prevented the boxers' participation. In February 2007, Pride 33, the second coming, brought the embattled company back to Vegas. It was not the final Pride show. But typical to how their fights often played out, it was like God himself was playing out a grand narrative arc with the fists and knees of the unknowing competitors. Ramu Terry Sokaju, an unknown judo competitor from Cameroon, went from massive underdog to victor in just 23 seconds by catching Antonio Rogério Nogueira with a brutal left hook. Announcer Josh Barnett described it as a car accident. It was one of the craziest fucking things anyone had ever seen, even in Pride.
And after a palate cleanser in the form of a broken-down legend in Hayato Sakurai quickly dispatching American Mac Danzig, we were off to the races. Pride was about to show everyone what the world would miss if they went the way of the dodo. Shogun Hua rematched former tournament foe Alistair Overeem. While the Brazilian's last outing was a lackluster decision over tough Japanese fighter Kaz Nakamura,
this time, Shogun took care of business more quickly by rolling Overeem on his back, taking a moment to size up his guard, and completely tearing it down with a decisive Superman punch.
Next was Nick Diaz and Takanori Gomi. We could do a whole 90-minute entry about both men, but I'll keep it short. Diaz was a socially maladroit triathlete who used his endless endurance to throw high volumes of punches and power his highly pedigreed ground game. He was a problem child and was just cut from the UFC for fighting his opponent in a hospital right after their match.
Takanori Gomi was a mercurial standout with an iron dome and nukes for hands.
By his own admission, he was starting to slack off at this point in his career. Though he suffered some lackluster wins and shocking losses, he was still a going commodity in the sport.
Their fight was as bizarre as they were. Diaz tried to hit a standing Kimura on Gomi in their first round and got rocked, then got back up, and got the kind of fight that he actually wanted. The two men threw absolute death at each other, but it was a pace only the American could keep up. In the second round, an exhausted and hurt Gomi went to take Diaz down and landed straight in a go-go plata, a submission that was literally invented as a joke. It was the third time it had ever been successfully applied in the sport, and the first by an American.
Well, it was until it was overturned as a no contest. After the fight, Diaz took a urine test for marijuana metabolites. According to the Nevada State Athletic Commission, a result of 15 nanograms per milliliter was generally considered positive, but they used a more lenient standard of 50, just to ensure their positive tests were beyond all reasonable doubt. Diaz pissed 175. The commission chair speculated that Diaz's performance may have been enhanced by this making him literally too numb to feel pain.
To digress from piss, our final fight. It was the iconic Dan Henderson, an American wrestler starring in another rematch. This one against Shogun's older brother in spirit, Wanderlei Silva. Wanderlei had already beaten Henderson once, but was unable to finish him. No one was. At this time, conventional knowledge dictated that Hendo was absolutely impossible to knock out. Though Wanderlei seemed to be a little bit shop-worn by the time he was trotted out to Vegas, he still had such a resume that he was a moderate favorite against the American. Unfortunately, Henderson always outperformed when he was the dog.
Henderson did his trademark gag of falling down while attempting a strike, but quickly got back up and used his wrestling to beat Wanderlei's ass for two rounds. Not in a huge, resounding way, but he was definitely winning. Wanderlei looked slow, Henderson looked comfortable, and it was probably going to be a victory for Decision Dan, as Henderson was called by forum users at the time.
Well, he must have gotten sick of that nickname, because in the third round, Henderson hit Wanderlei with a fucking spinning back fist and then completely shut his lights off with a left hook. Henderson was the Pride middleweight champion. Wanderlei looked like he was dead.
Diaz was leaking like a faucet, but he was so astronomically stoned that he might not have cared.
Shogun was smiling pleasantly somewhere. And everyone got to see why Pride was so cool, even if the uptight American Athletic Commission didn't let them bring over their soccer kicks from Japan. Just 1 month later, Dreamstage Entertainment announced that Zuffa, the UFC's parent company, would buy Pride's assets. This would be how Pride lived. Its best fighters would compete against the UFC's best, while the pomp and circumstance of their biggest shows would go on. 5 months later, the UFC declared that they just couldn't bring Pride back to Japan. They alluded to vague problems with fighter contracts and how weirdly they were written at times, how hard it was for them to get anything done over there, and unstated, but just as important, how Pride just wasn't the UFC brand. 2 months after that, Pride's offices in Japan closed. The UFC had just spent $65 million on a tape library and whatever contracts weren't too weird for them to renegotiate. The recession of 2008 permanently engendered cynicism in millions. While that November, unprecedented numbers of young people came out to vote for Barack Obama, most people's lives remained pretty shitty. None of the scumbag bankers went to jail. Most of the jobs created in the vaunted recovery thereafter were temporary positions, and the pain of seeing a system completely fail never leaves some people. It's not really part of our national discourse, but a lot of people completely checked out in 2008 and in the following years. It's not just Donald Trump's much-touted forgotten man. It's the fucked-up 19-year-old who hates himself because he doesn't feel like he's good at anything.
He feels like he'll never get the chance to grow up, and sees his parents who have to work until they die because they got wiped out by the market, and decides that he's right to give up. So the 26-year-old who did 5 unpaid internships in the last 4 years finally gets a permanent position and gets sexually harassed by some mid-level executive, but knows that HR exists to protect the company, and she has no savings anyway. So what is she going to do? It's the guy who got so mad after 9/11 that he joined the army and got to kill all the people that he said he would. And it just made him crazy enough to scare off everyone in his life every time he hears anything loud. 2008 didn't bring the pitchforks. It didn't scare any CEOs or private equity managers. It just made everyone too fucking beaten down for anyone who deserves it to ever see the inside of a cell. But people who have been flattened by the earth still live, even if they feel they don't fit in anywhere. And of course, one place was tailor-made in our culture for people that did not fit. As part of the nation pinned their hopes on Obama to make institutions trustworthy and functional, another part pinned their hopes to nativism and racial terror as a means to reclaim the halls of power. But amid all this, the UFC just remained their glittery, tacky selves. And holy shit, did it pay off. This was the perfect time for Brock Lesnar. Lesnar was America's largest son, a big, wet, pissed off Great Plains genetic freak who made his name in the WWE and came to the UFC to piss off every hardcore fan. Then make them throw their hats on the ground like Yosemite Sam when he actually won a UFC heavyweight title in 2008. Even though he beat Randy Couture, who was 45 years old and much smaller than Lesnar, it was an incredible accomplishment considering it was the pro wrestler's 4th ever MMA fight, and he had just been knee-barred by Frank Mir 9 months prior. UFC 100 was a celebration of every stupid thing about the promotion that was nearly snuffed out in its cradle, and it was like a coronation for Lesnar as the king of all pissed off men in America. But pretty much the entire card was great. In the third fight of the pay-per-view, Dan Henderson landed what is probably the most iconic knockout ever in MMA, when he seemingly murdered Michael Bisping. Next, 170-pound champion George St. Pierre completely shut down Brazilian Muay Thai specialist Thiago Alves in one of his more exciting-to-watch long-distance fights.
And in the main event, Brock Lesnar rematched Frank Mir, who said a bunch of utterly confounding things pre-fight and was ultimately shut up by 15 consecutive right-hand strikes. This, when coupled with the post-fight shit-talk, further established the former pro wrestler as the UFC's greatest heel.
UFC 100 was the biggest event the company had ever done at that point, clocking in 1.6 million pay-per-view buys, which is even more incredible when you realize that the gross domestic product of the United States was still contracting at this time. But then again, there's maybe nothing that strange about getting all those people to pay $50 to get all pissed off with their boy, with that going on in the backdrop. It wasn't just Brock, though. It seemed like around 2009, the UFC had picked up Pride's luck when it came to dramatic storylines in their fights. Previous rivalries in the UFC were things like the marble-mouthed Tito Ortiz shouting gibberish at the usually mum Chuck Liddell in between beatings at Liddell's hands. But things were different now. Let's take a look at Liddell's old kingdom of light heavyweight at this time. Shogun Hua shows up at the UFC fat and unprepared due to a knee injury, shocks everyone by losing to Ultimate Fighter guy Forrest Griffin, who shocks everyone again by beating Rampage Jackson for the belt. Griffin loses to another Ultimate Fighter winner everyone assumed was bad in Rashad Evans, who then gets completely outclassed by Lyoto Machida, a Brazilian karate champion whose style was so unusual that Joe Rogan literally declared, "Welcome to the Machida era," when he won.
Meanwhile, Shogun strings together some lackluster-looking wins and shows up to their title fight with everyone bracing themselves to see their pride favorite get knocked out, when he actually goes all 5 rounds and wins on everyone's scorecards but the judges. Gets a rematch, and takes the decision out of the judge's hands this time, decapitating Machida in one of the most cathartic knockouts in UFC history. There was no greater storyline than Chael Sonnen and Anderson Silva. Like all great fights, this one had some special context. Anderson Silva was seen as the best ever. After nearly quitting during his days in Pride due to two submission losses, Anderson became patient, a master of timing who knew how to keep his cool, keep his distance, and make you look like a fucking asshole for even trying when the moment came. Part of that was Antonio Rodrigo Nogueira befriending him and showing up holes in his game, but it was also Silva maturing as a competitor and as a man. When he came to the UFC in 2006, he destroyed the iron-shinned Chris Leben in under a minute, and was immediately granted a title shot. He carved up middleweight champ Rich Franklin and never looked back. Going into UFC 112, Anderson had defended his belt five times and ended up vacationing outside middleweight so he could take down a journeyman and former champ in his spare time. FITAOL was the UFC's first event in the Middle East, a token for Abu Dhabi's live events company Flash Entertainment buying a stake in Zuffa. This was largely thanks to Sheikh Tanoun bin Zayed, a member of Abu Dhabi's ruling family who is a huge MMA enthusiast. Years later, Flash Entertainment would divest itself of its partial ownership in Zuffa, but not before Sheikh Tanoun assumed the role of UAE's national security advisor. He was reportedly a key figure in the Emirates' involvement in the Yemeni civil war, which has drawn numerous allegations of war crimes. UFC 112 was held on Yas Island, where immigrant workers have allegedly been subject to forced labor and unacceptable living conditions. A special stadium had been built specifically for this event, in which the greatest fighter in the world was expected to deliver yet another spectacular performance. Instead, the 185-pound king danced, taunted, and mostly played with his food, utterly disgracing the special stadium that the Emiratis had so nicely made for him. Dana White and the fans were pissed. Dana even said that he would cut Anderson if he ever fought like that again. Before 112, Anderson was rumored to be up against George St. Pierre in a big money super fight, but after earning the ire of fans and management alike, he was given a hard fight without the same payday. He was given Chael Sonnen. Unlike Anderson's previous diet of humble Midwesterners and deferential Brazilians who feared his aura, Chael Sonnen's whole act was that he didn't give a shit. He promised to get in there and bust Anderson's ass. But during the lead up to this fight, there was another reigning master of the universe who had worn thin on guys who wear Fox Racing branded clothing as well. As always, I am speaking of Barack Obama. Obama impressed a lot of people during his rise, what with dispatching entrenched barnacles of his own party before cruising to a wide victory. While his idealism and commitment to national unity helped him win the title, once those qualities failed to manifest as real change, many who had bought into his promises grew disillusioned with him. But there was another group of people who could not ever be appealed to. In 2010, the nativist response to a black president in the form of the Tea Party was sweeping the nation. Like all authoritarians, they demanded a return to how things were in a different, fictional time, and tried to find every way that they could to say that Obama was illegitimate. Chael Sonnen played a similar tune. Anderson was not champion.
I think a black belt under the Nogueira brothers is saying I got a free toy in my Happy Meal.
Anderson was a feat.
I'm gonna put him on his prissy little ass.
Anderson was a big old foreign dipshit who was about to face a real American wrestler.
It's a step harder picking up that language than it is understanding pig Latin.
Chael's barbs were more rooted in pro wrestling routine and fight promotion than they were in white revanchism. But, like the Tea Party, it was seen as part entertaining sideshow, part insane bullshit, part a fun diversion to the stale reign of an unbeatable force that would eventually get its just desserts. Sonnen even had the personal weirdness of those old Tea Party candidates. He was a real estate agent who quit a state house race in Oregon because of later discovered sketchy business practices. After months of talking shit, Chael Sonnen and Anderson Silva entered the cage at UFC 117 in Oakland, California.
Before their match, Anderson had brought in Steven Seagal to train him as an elaborate joke, showing how little he gave a shit. At the pre-fight presser, he didn't even look at Sonnen. He was going back to the old Spider, right? Just go into bullet time and lay this guy out. In little over a minute into round one, Chell did what no man in the UFC had done to that point and rocked Anderson Silva. To this day, people still debate whether Anderson was actually dropped or if Chell just pounced on him once his knees buckled, but his ass hit the ground one way or the other. The pressure fighter stayed heavy on top of Anderson, cleaning his clock with punches, smothering his mouth, and just generally making the greatest look like another guy who couldn't figure out a wrestler. Then he did it again. And again. For four rounds, Chael absolutely tooled Anderson all over the place, and he did exactly what he said he would do.
I'm gonna put him on his prissy little ass.
Long derided as just another boring wrestler, he actually showed some flair. At one point, taking Anderson down from his own guard. Not sweeping him with some fancy jiu-jitsu, just picking up Anderson's legs while flat on his fucking back and dumping him on his ass as he was all night. Going into round five, Anderson's corner was just short of tears, pleading with their fighter to retain his honor by at least avoiding the takedown this time. Was this how it ended? It always was. The unbeatable don't go out in flashes. They get dismantled anticlimactically, losing lopsided decisions or getting finished late, proving that the cruel randomness of the sport is never flukes, but how much changes, and how quickly. How it can be a fucking journeyman with 10 losses who just figures out a couple new things that confound someone you thought was Bruce Lee. For half that final round, that's what everyone was thinking. Then Anderson did something atypical. He threw out a technique, not with lightning quick execution and smoothness, but sloppy, clearly using the last bits left in him. He willed a grappling technique, a triangle choke into existence. Chell was going to get out of this. We're all going to get our hearts broken. No fucking point in even investing in this one. Except Chell didn't. He just fell tighter and tighter into it. At 3 minutes and 10 seconds, Anderson used the loose triangle setup to take Chell's arm. And Chell quit. Months after UFC 117, Republicans riding the Tea Party wave utterly demolished the Obama coalition. They picked up 63 seats in the House, 6 in the Senate, 680 seats in state legislatures, and 6 governorships. Nothing on paper, like Obama's margins 2 years before or bad national polling for GOP policies, mattered. In the real world, there were no astounding outcomes. Barack Obama and the Democrats couldn't do the unthinkable. They were no more able to accomplish tangible things like universal healthcare than they were their lofty bullshit goals like healing social fracture in a crumbling empire. The Tea Party psychos who stormed into the House were no more able themselves. They couldn't accomplish their tangible goal of repealing Obamacare, nor could they make it so Obama wasn't black and wasn't their president. There's no magic out there when it comes to the contest over resources that determine the courses of our lives and the lives of our children. We just relive our cycles, hoping that we can be good enough to make it out of this one, With all the cheap fake money from the finance world and all the resentment that bubbles in the twilight of an empire, drawing our backs to our Promethean punishment. We hope that so many of us aren't beaten down by circumstance that they can remain in the fight. And we hope those that are can at least have some slightly less monstrous healthcare system or something that allows them to escape, even just for a few hours on a Saturday night. The magic is elsewhere. The magic that we wish we saw everywhere else was in the cage, because it was conjured by people who were just too fucked up to make it in the dull, constantly disappointing world outside. In a world where everything seemed to get slightly better than slightly worse at a more constant rate, at least there was one place where unthinkable things actually happened. At least if you put two weird people with incredible abilities in front of each other, their combined experiences and opposing martial abilities would create a beautiful, maddening story. How did we fuck that up? Up next, the end of history. No one's ever content to just like something, especially not nowadays. In his 2005 book, American Theocracy, former Republican strategist Kevin Phillips postulated that Americans' language choices and media consumption habits in correlation with our increasing wealth inequality and right-wing politics showed us tilting more towards a theocratic monarchy than a republic. We were not just fans of things anymore. We declare our media consumption habits to determine the types of people we are, segregating ourselves by which reality TV family we identify with. The rich make-believe duck hicks, or the impossibly beautiful children of one of O.J. Simpson's friends. We assign political meaning to individual pop stars and spend countless hours fighting battles for them online against faceless drones. Battles that our millionaire entertainers will probably never give a shit about or even find out about. When the idea of executing power and the division of resources was abandoned as a political possibility, we threw all our eggs into culture, and now if someone doesn't like something we like, they hate us, our way of life, and our identities. On to the very secure Dana White. Pay-per-view buys were 10 to 20 times what they were 6 short years before. Dana had never made it a secret that he wanted the UFC brand of MMA to be as big as the NFL or NBA. In 2008, he projected that in the next 5 years, the UFC would be bigger than soccer globally. In 2012, he declared that it would be the biggest brand in the world, bigger than the NFL. In 2014, he claimed that the UFC was already bigger than soccer in Brazil. Dana's obsession makes sense, primarily from a money standpoint, as the already incredibly wealthy UFC president and 9% stakeholder would stand to be a billionaire dozens of times over. But Dana White is also an MMA fan, and there's a very real insecurity in MMA fans. Whether you're watching a shitty UK stream on your friend's off-brand tablet, or you're the president of the world's biggest promotion, sometimes you may feel a little self-conscious about our dumb sport. Everyone who loves the sport has had a moment where they watch an event with a friend, a family member, or a romantic partner. It was probably during the pay-per-view golden age of the late 2000s, where the person you hoped would become just as obsessed as you saw men in awful tattoos wearing shorts that said Condom Depot in huge letters on them push one another against a fence for 15 minutes. Or one just completely teed off on the other and made him leak before making him fall victim to a scary falling tree knockout. Either way, your target audience found it too weird, too boring, too terrifying, or all three. And the cultural image of MMA fighters is a bunch of enormous angry men with weird tattoos who always seem to be yelling. And the image of fans is a sea of guys with big guts and chiseled arms wearing affliction shirts and getting wasted before assaulting random passers-by. But does it matter? We love this sport. We love the weird people like John Jones who are actually pretty fascinating when you get to know them and have more depth than most would know. We know those grappling exchanges that people find boring often take a lot of skill. When we see someone fall like they just got ripped by a Barrett 50 cal, we know it's no more dangerous than any given second of NFL action. We love it, and that's all that should matter. And Dana White loves it, and he's made hundreds of millions of dollars more than we have, so he should be even happier with it than we are. And who gives a shit if we don't have hundreds of millions of people watching with us every time? And why do we care if people think we're fucked up or weird for watching it? We know what our sport is, and we know who we are, from the most stereotypical ones to the grandmothers and grad students who get just as excited as the affliction shirt guys for every card. It's our stupid, violent, insane spectacle sport for freaks and assholes that's as legitimate or illegitimate as any other sport in the world. Well,
at least it was ours at some point.
Sometimes you want something so bad, you don't care how bad it is for you. And the UFC just really wanted that legitimacy. Now, most of the sports that Dana and the UFC wishes that MMA was more like have three commonalities. One is a network TV presence. The next is standardized uniforms. And the third is drug testing. After the gold rush of the late 2000s, the UFC achieved all three, to the detriment of the viewers, the fighters, and ultimately, themselves. First came the Fox deal. In August of 2011, the UFC announced that they had signed a deal with Fox Sports. Previously, the UFC would air the preliminaries to their big pay-per-views on Spike TV, which also housed The Ultimate Fighter. Now, Fox Sports and FX would air prelims and The Ultimate Fighter, but more importantly, there were to be hugely important fights held on Fox's main channel on network TV. People freaked out. Our sport had made it. We're no longer airing fights in between shows called, like, Boner Patrol and Boob Professor. We're network now. Everyone rhapsodized about the big network TV boxing matches of the 1970s and 80s, reasoning that our sport that was once relegated to a dumb cable channel for idiots like Spike and pay-per-view would have the cultural importance of Muhammad Ali and Sugar Ray Leonard's historic bouts. Mice and men, though. On the first network TV UFC card ever, heavyweight champion Cain Velasquez was brought in to defend his belt against Brazilian boxing specialist Junior Dos Santos in what fight watchers thought would be the UFC opening up the Mexican market. Cain was undefeated, had just destroyed Brock Lesnar, and was very proud of his Mexican heritage. He was supposed to use his brutal wrestle boxing to destroy JDS over the course of an exciting 25-minute fight and win millions of new Mexican fans tuning into Fox. Dos Santos knocked him out in 64 seconds. The UFC's production team spent the next 40 or so minutes awkwardly filling time, as Dana gritted his teeth and Fox executives probably tossed their 10-gallon hats on the ground. Maybe God was trying to tell Dana White something. After this bad omen, people started realizing what the deal actually meant. While there would be some big matches on network, Fox inked the deal because the UFC would bring viewers to unloved cable networks like Fuel TV and Fox Sports 1 and 2. To sweeten the pot more, the deal mandated that the UFC owed constant fights on those platforms. In meeting their obligation without burying big events on smaller platforms, the UFC greatly increased the amount of events they held every year. Their promotion went from 27 events in 2011, all the way to 41 in 2016. In comparison, there were 20 events for all of 2009. Because it increased the amount of cards, it necessitated contracting more fighters to save the more skilled athletes with more fans to the biggest money makers on pay-per-view and Big Fox, as MMA fans called it. The roster of fighters under contract used to be in a mostly steady 200 to 300 range with a half dozen cut at a time for performance or other issues. Now, it will swell to the upper 500s before dozens are cut at once after they lose several in a row, lose once in a particularly boring fashion, blow a drug test, or just annoy the company in one way or the other. The company then finds some more guys that they can shove out there. Someone may say that it's good that more fighters are getting paid. Well, you can hardly call the highly temporary space fillers the UFC pumps and dumps paid. The lowest level signees get $10,000 to show and $10,000 to win. Pretty good, right? Nope. Let's say our guy shows up and wins. He gets $20,000 for 50 minutes of work or less, right? At the end of the day, he's probably looking at about $7,000 for his trouble, if he wins.
If you're a moron, you'll say that's for 15 minutes of work. He had to train for 2 months and will get to fight 3 more times that year at the very most, If he wins all those, which is highly unlikely, he takes home $28,000 for getting CTE, not getting licenses or skills for the other jobs he would need after the decade of fighting he can do at the very most, and shithead podcasters making fun of his haircut on Twitter during his thankless task of filling the undercard.
So, after oversaturating fans, making cards shittier and less important, and uberizing fighter labor, the UFC decided the next step to legitimacy was standardizing how fighters dressed.
Just a few years ago, there was a middle class in fighting. These were guys who never won a belt, and often never even fought for one, but through a mix of exciting fights, unique personalities, and strong fan bases, were able to secure loads of sponsorship money for every fight.
But in 2014, the UFC put a stop to that. They announced that they had signed a reported 6-year, $70 million deal with Reebok. The UFC had, in recent years, imposed a heavy sponsor tax to get their cut of the action. But now, they were the action. They claimed that the majority of the deal would be paid out to fighters and benefit newbies the most.
As it happened, newbies got $2,500, later bumped to $3,500, to wear the company's hideous and boring apparel.
While it's more than many got, it's still a pittance, and the problem of the lower rung of fighters not making enough could be solved by the UFC just paying them more.
Veterans, on the other hand, got comprehensively fucked. Before the Reebok deal, there was no limit on how much they could make in sponsorship money. Now, their ceiling is $40,000 per fight.
While this may seem like a great deal when combined with a champion or main event fighter's pay, keep in mind that our athletes have 10 years where they can do this if they're lucky, maybe 3 years of fighting on such a high level, and very often have no other marketable skills for when their bodies and brains are too beaten up to continue. And the middle class, they are wiped out. Now that the sport looked more boring, fighters were stretched more financially, and there were way too many fights, let's take a gander at that third chamber of sports legitimacy, stringent drug testing. The vast majority of your favorite athletes use steroids. And no, it doesn't make them bad people, and no, it doesn't make them invincible. It gives them more strength and endurance, but most importantly for them, it helps them recover from injury. Steroids are actually kind of amazing. The human body is absolutely not designed to fight for 15 to 25 minutes, but steroids help make it work. And those injuries that were once death sentences to a fighter's career, stuff like ACL tears, steroids will help with those. I mean, yes, they have their side effects, of course, but my point is, it is impossible to compete at the highest levels of fighting without some chemical help. Talk to any retired fighter, and they'll give you a number anywhere from 75 to 90% of their former training partners juicing. Well, in June of 2015, the UFC announced it was starting an anti-doping program with the US Anti-Doping Agency, and man has it fucked things up. The punishment for performance-enhancing drugs, which can often just be byproducts of over-the-counter substances, are 2 years for a first offense, double for your second, and double that for your third. For substances like cocaine and marijuana, it's the same math, except 1 year for a fighter's first offense. It used to be you'd banned for a year at most, and that was if you flagged a few times before. Now we have to be very capricious so people will respect our sport. USADA testing has flagged numerous fighters, great and small, for the wrong stuff in their blood. But at the absolute highest level of the sport, no one was derailed by this as much as John Jones. Jones became the champion of the light heavyweight division in 2011, utterly thrashing Shogun Hua in a fight that made us all a little sad and maybe hate Jones just a little bit. Here was a giant freak athlete who did moves that he learned off of YouTube to humiliate fighters we grew up with. And to make it worse, he was a goody-goody who bragged that he snitched on kids who smoked weed when he was still in high school. He met Lyoto Machida and Rampage Jackson and ran through the two beloved former champions, angering people even more. But as Fleetwood Mac said, time made you bolder, even children get older, and I'm getting older too.
As we got to know John more, we saw his personal foibles, like his DUI arrest and rivalry with Rashad Evans.
We no longer saw the fake moralizing asshole who beat everyone up. We saw a uniquely damaged guy who experienced the death of his sister at a young age, being the skinny runt amongst two brothers in the NFL,
becoming a father at an age too young, and also happening to be the best in the world at beating the shit out of other people. He was the person with failings who sometimes acted like an asshole, got pissed off and said incredibly cutting things to his opponents. But he had real human vulnerabilities we almost never saw. He had an incredible rivalry with Olympic wrestler Daniel Cormier, and holy shit do those guys hate each other. Before defending his title in May, John had a hit-and-run incident and was stripped of his belt, and then proceeded to powerlift for a year straight, and he became great at that, too. He came back in April of 2016 to defeat Ovin St. Preux in order to capture the interim light heavyweight belt. He was Napoleon returning from Elba, poised to make $10 million in a rematch for the unified belt with Daniel Cormier at UFC 200, one of the biggest cards of all time. 3 days before, he got popped by USADA and was suspended for a year. Still young, John returned in July of 2017 to fight Cormier again, who is the new king in his absence. It was an emotional lead-up, with both men expressing their undying hatred for one another even more than the last time.
The guy's never beaten me. In order to be the champion, you have to beat the champion. Until he beats me, that belt over there is a piece of shit.
Are you back, Junkie?
I'm back.
You've got two more months before you're actually back.
Yeah, exactly. And you better love these next 2 months, Daniel, which I'm sure you do. Make Christmas cards now because the belt's gonna be gone, Daniel.
I'm gonna beat your punk ass.
Did you guys forget?
I'm gonna beat your punk ass. Stop looking for them to save you.
Did the record?
They can't save you. Is he really gonna be in Anaheim? Is this guy gonna mess this up again by doing steroids or snorting cocaine or sandblasting prostitutes?
I beat you after a weekend of cocaine. Back-to-back weekends. Cocaine one, your ass the next.
That's one hell of a weekend for a millionaire druggie.
They had an amazing close fight. But John Jones being John Jones, he knocked Cormier out with a Street Fighter head kick. And also because he is John Jones, he tested positive for PEDs again. Is he a fucking idiot? In the sense of blowing up his own career, yes. But in combat, Jones is a genius who can destroy world champions with stuff he saw in a movie. The equivalent to those savant kids who can hear a song once and instantly play it on piano perfectly. It used to matter less if you acted like an idiot. Everyone was a bit of an idiot in one manner or the other in life. But God forbid you now embarrass the sport in front of a world that has already deemed you niche. It's a little bit amazing to me that Dana White, a fervent Trump supporter who spoke at the Republican National Convention in 2016, is so obsessed with achieving norms. What are you, afraid that people won't respect you? There is no respect anymore. There is no veneer in front of the spectacle and vulgarity. And you wanted it that way. Why are you trying to stick Jeb Bush's exclamation point on MMA? The UFC admittedly made some good decisions in the 2010s. The promotion now features women's MMA, all because Dana White really, really liked Ronda Rousey and created the 135-pound women's division in 2013 just for her. Rousey was a massive star, earning millions of pay-per-view buys and destroying everyone in her path, with only one meaningful rival in Miesha Tate. Tate never beat her, she just found a way to last all the way into the third round before getting destroyed, which was two rounds longer than anyone else to that point. Rousey ended up doing movies, and somewhere along the way, lost her love of the sport just as people figured out her game. She got knocked out by Holly Holm after a first round that looked like she was trying to set up what she always did and just couldn't. Then steamrolled without a prayer by Amanda Nunes. But thanks to the necessity of more fights, we also got the women's 115-pound division, and even women's MMA agnostics and haters eventually had to concede that it had some amazing fights. Joanna Jędrzejczyk, a Polish Muay Thai standout with an unbelievably charming personality and extraordinary cruel streak.
Compare me to them. Come on. They cannot compare themselves to me. They cannot. I'm telling to them, bow down. Bow down. I'm the queen. Thank you, guys.
Ran the table at strawweight for a while before getting knocked out bad by Rose Namajunas. What's interesting about the 115-pound division is that women's MMA used to be notorious for lacking exciting knockouts, smooth technique, and more than one or two great fighters per division. Of course, this was a function of there being no money or airtime in it. Pioneers like Gina Carano and Cristiana Justino paved the way by demolishing their far less skilled competition, but it was a few years before Rousey showed up, made insane amounts of money, and made dozens of women realize it could be a viable path. The UFC actually investing time and money into women's 115 was kind of atypical for the company in this era, because it required foresight, patience, and doing something that would actually generally be good for the sport. And I would be remiss to forget Conor McGregor, who, with Nate Diaz, broke the UFC's all-time pay-per-view record at 1.65 million buys at UFC 202. Tons of people utterly despise Conor because he wears three-piece suits when he goes to Chipotle and says insane braggadocious stuff that he often backs up.
A lot of people say he's the best pound-for-pound fighter in the world.
He's not.
How do you rank the fighters?
I'm number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9.
But I think Conor, like John Jones's drug testing, is an interesting case study in the UFC's war with its own brand identity. While the UFC spent the next 4 years cracking down on fighters having any distinct appearance and identity, Conor, like Ronda Rousey, was allowed to be who he wanted to be, which was a flashy, loudmouth Irish bog man.
I'm a lion in there, and I'm going to eat you alive. People. Your little gazelle friends are going to be staring through the cage, looking at you getting your carcass getting eaten alive, and they can do nothing.
Out,
all they're
going
to do is say,
no,
we're never going to cross this river again.
Why? Because Dana White liked him. Same reason as Ronda. Within a few fights, Conor was dining with the Fertittas, going on joyrides with Dana, and dressing, acting, and taking sponsorship deals however he saw fit. Conor has made hundreds of millions of dollars for the UFC and its owners. But really, anyone they allowed to have a distinct identity and fan base could make them way more money than they are now. Currently, only Conor is allowed to be bigger than the UFC brand. We're in a scary new time for the UFC. A handful of top fighters have left the Bellator, a decidedly B-League promotion, because they allow fighters to have sponsors that actually pay them.
Conor McGregor left to cash the paycheck of a lifetime in boxing and didn't fight in the UFC at all in 2017. That year, pay-per-view buys dropped by about 50%. In July of 2016, the UFC was sold to Hollywood talent agency WME and three private equity firms, one led by Michael Dell of Dell Computers, as well as Kohlberg, Kravis, and Roberts, a group of corporate raiders who have been stripping assets and cashing out for decades.
The UFC's misbegotten desire for prestige and the machinations of the sport move independent of any stakeholder. The evolution of technique itself is often uncaring to capital as we enter the fourth era of fighting itself. Fighters in this sanitized, oversaturated era are pretty much good at everything. So good that they have trouble finishing each other. The fourth era of fighting is about conditioning, athleticism, and peaking the body's performance so you can be a couple microseconds faster than your opponent in order to knock them out, take a limb, but almost as likely, rack up microsecond victories over the course of 15 to 25 minutes. It's very appropriate. In the old days of fighting, fighting transcended the world around it. In the first age of globalization, it was Elio and Kimura fighting nationalistic battles that ended in mutual respect, as opposed to the faulty world orders and generations of resentment left by the nationalistic wars at the time. In the 1990s, it was a respite from the more contemporary pains of globalization, something real amid an increasingly sanitized, standardized, and unrewarding world. When it became big in Japan, it was the bombast and largeness of life that the lost decade sapped from everybody. And when every institution failed Americans and left millions feeling dislocated, it gave people the honesty of a fistfight and a cultural haven for strange people. But our era now is defined by a lack of conclusion. Our generals won't even tell us how many people we have in Afghanistan and Iraq. We're funding and arming the original groups we said we were going to fight when we set out on our foreign adventures this time. Nations we democratized by killing a sizable chunk of their population and profiting off their infrastructure never get an ending, happy or sad. They fight civil wars at varying intensity from year to year. The defining traumas of our era had no conclusion. None of the scumbag bankers went to jail for destroying the economy in 2008. All the weak rules put in place after are all but erased.
We elected a president we thought was transformative, and the person that followed him was a goblin whose image invokes the robber barons of 100 years ago.
There are no closed cycles, conclusions, or even abrupt endings now. We're all condemned to each other in purgatory. The rest of the world around us is breaking free of its norms, only to see them revert to them, just with margins behaving irregularly. Donald Trump wins the presidential election, and for all his paleoconservative bluster and destruction of norms, governs policy-wise almost identically to any other Republican. But the edges of our reality fray so much that it drives us even more insane. There was an equivalent event in fighting, the Mayweather-McGregor fight, that saw the previously unthinkable matchup of an active UFC champion and a boxing legend not too far removed from his years at top. It was a massive event that defied all our previous expectations of what was possible, then reverted to exactly what we always thought would happen. The boxer won a boxing match, and the rest of the world was largely the same.
Sometimes the dam of normalcy breaks and we get momentary bursts of how things once were. And when it does, the UFC doesn't seem sure of which side it wants to be on. At UFC 229, Conor returned after nearly 2 years away from the sport. Months prior, he'd escalated a long simmering feud with lightweight Khabib Nurmagomedov when he showed up in Brooklyn and attacked a bus carrying the undefeated Russian. The UFC was all too happy to roll video of the incident into their promotional packages, including the pre-fight press conference.
Proper Irish whiskey from a proper Irish man. Here's a gargle for you, Dana. Proper 12.
I'm not a
proper 12 on me. Hang toy.
Dana also seemed unbothered when a whiskey-hawking McGregor continued to hurl insults at the stoic Nurmagomedov.
His own countrymen, his own people that he's turned his back on, they want to see him gone too, and I am going to do it in the name of the Russian people. So here's my location, you little fool, right in front of you. Do something about it. Do something about it. Yeah, you'll do nothing.
It wasn't much of a shock to see Conor submit to the greatest functional wrestler in MMA a few minutes into the fourth round. Similarly, it could have been predicted that Conor's words and actions just might bear fruit in the form of further violence outside the octagon when Khabib, spurred on by further taunting from Conor's corner, leapt out of the cage and instigated a brawl. This was the most watched UFC event of all time, shattering Conor's old record from 202. Countless people, curious to see what the spectacle of MMA was all about, had tuned in just in time to see all their preconceived notions of the sport validated. And now, all of a sudden, Dana was troubled by the extracurricular violence.
Many of you, I know there's a lot of media here tonight, and some of you, this is your first event. I can promise you this is not what a mixed martial arts event is normally like. This is not what we're about. This isn't what we do. This isn't how we act, and you know, it's unfortunate that the night that the most people are watching.
The UFC wants both freakish spectacle and mainstream respect. It wants both the depravity of a blood sport and the decorum of every sport it wishes it was like. What was once a weird refuge for those who needed it is now eroding into just another thing that's as formless and indistinct as everything else.
Fighting has rid itself of so much of its magic. It does not transcend the world anymore. It is our world. If you've somehow made it to the end of this and you're not an MMA fan, I hope you take one thing away from all of this. This will happen to everything that you love. Nothing you like will remain untouched, and it will get further and further monetized into meaninglessness. This isn't just our problem in our idiotic blood sport. You're fucked too. When Donald Cowboy Cerrone fought Nate Diaz at UFC 141, he rolled into the center of the cage with all the animosity of their pre-fight buildup behind them, squared up and prepared to unload on Diaz. But Diaz hit him, at first with punches that, if not overly powerful, came in volume. He did it again, and again and again. Every time it seemed Cerrone could land a blow that may change the course of the fight, Diaz kept hitting him. He started shoving him around and hitting him harder and harder. Even when Cerrone landed a head kick that floored the Californian, Diaz just got back up and kept hitting him. It went on like this. In the corner before the third and final round, Cerrone's cerebral coach, Greg Jackson, dropped his Zen routine and yelled at the fighter, 5 minutes for the rest of your life, cowboy.
You give me 5 minutes of hell. You understand me, son? You give me 5 minutes of hell.
He went out, got hit for 5 more minutes, and he lost. For the rest of your life, go out, touch gloves, and fight.